This is the day that the Lord has made, so let us rejoice and be glad in it. Hi. Good morning, church. It is good to be here with y'all and to see everyone. And it is exciting to be back and honestly to try to remember how to do this and what goes on here. If you are new with us, or if maybe you just forgot who I was, my name is Kevin White. I'm the pastor here of Calvin Presbyterian Church, and I want to start this morning by saying thank you. Thank you for your prayers and your support of my and therefore of Rachel and Ezra's as well in my taking a sabbatical these past 3 months. Thank you to Kathy Cooper and her husband Keith for letting her come here on Sunday mornings all this summer for doing such a wonderful job as a preacher and worship leader and planner and pastoral care giver. Thank you to the deacons and elders and everybody who stepped up and stepped into new probably some new roles, new things. Everyone here who made sure that the work of the church continued and, dare I say, even grew and expanded over these past 3 months. I imagine that there were places of stretching and being challenged, and I'm sure that things came up where we said, oh my goodness, we didn't even think about, we forgot to plan about that. Kevin forgot to plan about that. We forgot to plan about that. I have no doubt that that happened, but I think those are also the places where we look back and we say, wow, you know, God was there and something new and exciting happened. So thank you for all who were open to something new and different this summer. I know Jennifer Cameron even preached once, so it's good to know I got somebody else on the list now. I don't know, Jennifer, did I see you come in somewhere? Oh, yes. All right, well, you're on my list now, so. I look forward to hearing about this summer and discovering with y'all how we're going to take this summer experience, yours and mine, and together and see. We're going to take it into Calvin's future and see what God is going to do with it and how God is going to lead us forward and how we're going to receive and respond and follow in all of that. Because sabbaticals are not just for pastors. They are for churches and communities because they are fundamentally spaces to hear, to listen and hear God perhaps in a new and different way, to get into a different sort of rhythm. And to maybe hear or see God from a different angle, and in that even discover new avenues of ministry. In fact, when we gather for worship, as we are doing right now here in this place, and with those who are joining online, we are trusting that even as we hear and respond to the same good news of Jesus and of the God who is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow, that in and through the Spirit at work in the gathered community of God, that we will hear and respond in fresh, ever new and ever being made new ways. And so I invite us now as we begin our time of worship on this new day to join me in prayer as we continue our time together this morning. Almighty God, as your Spirit hovered and brooded over the waters of creation, and from those waters called forth life, new life, and as you freed and released your people from bondage through the waters of the sea and into and for new life as your people, and here as the waters of baptism remind us that we too have been called into the life, death, and resurrected life of Christ, and therefore into the community of your people, O Lord. Let your grace and peace grow in us And even now, in this time as we are gathered to worship you this morning, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. This morning, Peter Cameron, who is one of our elders on session, and is in fact our clerk of session, Peter is assisting in worship this morning and will now lead us in our call to worship.
Good morning. Please join me in our responsive call to worship, which is adapted from the song celebrating the release of God's people sung by Moses and by Miriam in Exodus 15. Please respond with the bold print. I will sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. It is the Lord who saves. Who is like you, O Lord, among the gods? It is the Lord who delivers. The Lord will reign forever and ever. Let us sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. So let us now sing. Please stand in body or in spirit and join in singing our opening hymn, Make Me a Channel of Your Peace, which can be found in the bulletin insert. Please be seated. As we come to our time of confession, hear these words from the Apostle Paul in his letter to the Romans. Why do you pass judgment on your brother or sister? Or you, why do you despise your brother or sister? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. We are not here to pass judgment on each other, but rather to confess together and hear together and be changed together by the good news we have received. So please join in our corporate prayer of confession, which we will be followed by a moment of personal silent confession. Let us pray. Merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart and mind and strength, and much like it, we have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been, help us amend what we are, and direct what we shall be, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Now, a moment for personal confession. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen. In the very same chapter, the apostle also offers this assurance, declaring, "We do not live to ourselves and we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again." Beloved, this is the good news, that even when we struggle and sin, we have been claimed by God as God's very own in the life and death of Jesus Christ. So believe in the good news that in Jesus Christ we are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
Glory be to the Father.
We do indeed have the peace of Christ. So may the peace of Christ be with you. And we are called to share that peace with one another, so let us do so now. I'm going to invite the children to come up for our time with the children. So come on up and meet me over here. We're going to sit on this pew. Come on up. Yeah, come on. All right. Hi. Hi. How are we? How is everybody? It's been a while. Do you remember me? Okay, good. I remember y'all too. Well, I was thinking about some of what we're going to read here. Peter's going to read from the Bible in just a minute. And there's something I think that's kind of surprising that Jesus says. And we're actually going to begin a time reading each week for a little while of this surprising thing that Jesus says, and then he will tell a story or he'll share something. And that is, and he said this a lot, he said something like, "For the kingdom of heaven is like," or "the kingdom of heaven can be compared to." And then today, for example, he's going to tell a story. And I was wondering, what is a kingdom? Jesus talks about a kingdom a lot, and he says the kingdom of heaven, or the kingdom of God, is like, and he has these stories and these things he tells. What is a kingdom? Yeah, a place people live. It's a place where not just one, but it's a community of people, and it's a place where somebody rules over. So when Jesus talks about the kingdom of heaven, what do you think he's talking about? Who's ruling there?
Jesus.
God. Yeah, he's talking about places where God is ruling and the ways of God are happening. And so Jesus isn't just talking about some far-off place. I think he's also talking about when he tells us what the kingdom of heaven is like. He's telling us how we can know that we're a part of the kingdom of heaven right here. And we can live like that, like God's people. Like we are people who are part of the kingdom of heaven because we are. The other thing Jesus does when he talks about this is he tells stories or he gives examples of things. And I was thinking, that's pretty cool. He takes things that everyone knows about and sees and tells them in ways to help us understand what it's like to live when God is in control, how we're supposed to live. And I thought, you know what would be really fun? If we did that together too. So I thought that we would have, we're going to try this for a few weeks, see how it works. I have this bag. It's going to be our surprise bag. So I wonder if I have a surprise in here. Let's see. Uh-oh. Is there anything in here? No. I have an idea. Do you think that you all could help me talk about maybe what the kingdom is like and what God is like over the next couple weeks, and maybe on further than that? What if together we took turns bringing something surprising in here, and then we looked at it and we said, how does this help us know who God is? Sound like fun? All right, so here's my assignment. I need a volunteer for next week. Someone who's going to be here. Any volunteers? Here's what you have to do. At home, over the next week, you have to think about something. It could be a favorite toy or something that you like or something from around the house, something that fits in this bag, and I want you to put it in this bag and don't tell me what it is. And then you bring it next week, and we look at it together and we see, how does this help us know what God is like and what God's love is like? So really the pressure's on me. Do you think we can do that? Do I have any volunteers for next week? Cooper and Lorraine together, would you like to volunteer? Are you all going to be? Oh, you're not going to be here. Oh, Evan, are you going to be here? Evan can volunteer. All right, Evan, I want you to bring something in this bag, and then together we're going to see if it can help us figure out what the kingdom of heaven is like. Okay? Again, all the pressure's on me here. So we can do this together. I thought this would be fun. All right, let's have our prayer. Lord, we thank you for the surprising ways that you show up, the surprising ways that you teach us about yourself, about your love for us, and the love you call us into. Be with us now as we go, as we hear your word, and all God's children said, amen. All right, you can go back to your seats. Uh-oh. Mom's laughing kind of. Oh, she's got an idea.
Our scripture reading this morning is from the Gospel of Matthew. And it will be found in verses 21 through 35 in chapter 18. If you'd like to follow along, it can be found on page 20 in the New Testament in your pew Bible. As we prepare to hear God's word, let us pray. Faithful God, how blessed are those who hunger for justice and thirst for righteousness. Sanctify us by your word and spirit so that we may glorify you in the company of the faithful. Let us not just be hearers of the word, but doers through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. From Matthew 18, verses 21 to 35. Then Peter came and said to Jesus, Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as seven times? Jesus said to him, not seven times, but I tell you, 77 times. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his servants. When he began the reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. And as he could not pay, his Lord ordered him to be sold, together with his wife and children, and all his possessions, and payment to be made. So the servant fell on his knees before him, saying, "Have patience with me, and I will pay you everything." And out of pity for him, the Lord of that servant released him and forgave him the debt. But that same servant, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii. And seizing him by the throat, he said, "Pay what you owe." Then his fellow servant fell down and pleaded with him, "Have patience with me, and I will pay you." But he refused. Then he went and threw him into prison until he could pay the debt. When his fellow servants saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their Lord all that had taken place. Then his Lord summoned him and said to him, "You wicked servant, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow servant as I had mercy on you?" And in anger, his Lord handed him over to be tortured until he would pay his entire debt. So my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from your heart. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Okay, let's hope I remember how to do this. As you noticed, we are picking up again with the gospel according to Matthew. After spending this summer, I understand y'all and Kathy were in the Old Testament readings each Sunday throughout the summer, right? Moving through from, where'd you start in Genesis? Somewhere, it was with Abraham, right? Yeah, it started kind of with Abraham and moved through, and I think last week you were just right about God about to free the people. Is that right? I don't ask you, I should be asking them. Right, these stories of God forming and then in Exodus redeeming a people, a community, a family of and for God, and in that for the world. Right, we remember that original covenant with Abram back before he was even Abraham, that through him and through this people God was forming, all the nations were going to be blessed. All of this through a profoundly imperfect family and group and community of people, right? I mean, there was dysfunction through that whole family. But through it all, God is shaping and forming, reshaping, reforming a people, a community, to be God's people in the world, God's community in the world again and again and again, right? To be a particular type of people for the world. And we had the opportunity this summer, Rachel, Ezra, and I, to take a family trip. Actually, really, it was the first just us family vacation, family trip that we've ever really had. So again, thank you. And part of this in our travels was we spent a few days in Denmark. Truth be told, we went to Denmark because that's where Lego is headquartered. But as it happens, and I have a sermon prepared for that too at some point, I'm keeping the back of my head. As it happens, I have Danish ancestors. I have great-great-grandparents on my mom's side of the family who immigrated from Denmark to the U.S., Anna and Jens Christensen. They immigrated to Chicago. And it seems that they actually played a big role in organizing and even founding the Danish Lutheran churches there. Well, as it turns out, where we were staying in the city of Billund was not too far from the town that they immigrated from. Hvetsel, I think I've pronounced that right, Hvetsel. And so we went there. It's a small town, basically the church and some houses around it, maybe a shop or two. And the church, Hvetsel Kirke, the Hvetsel Church. And nobody was there when we got there at that particular moment, but we walked around anyway. The door was open. I went in and saw the place. Actually, here is a picture of me in that church. Right? I saw the place where Anna and Jens, my ancestors, had gathered with their community to worship all those years ago. We saw generations of Christensens in the graveyards around the church. To be fair, I think in Denmark, the name Christensen is kind of like the name Smith here, so probably not all my relatives, but surely and certainly some of them were. And they were all our relatives in the faith. And that same faith that Anna and Jens carried with them and in them as they traveled across the world and helped plant it in new ways in Chicago and then through the generations. I am, I realized, a Presbyterian, not Lutheran, but I think they'd be okay with that, right? A Presbyterian, a minister. No doubt a part of that community of faith is a part of me. So I left a little note at that church, hoping desperately that someone there could not only read English, but decipher my handwriting of English as well, just letting them know how profound it was to be in that place. What does it mean to be not just any old community, but a community of faith? And not just any old generic faith, but a particular faith. One that is connected by the Spirit through the generations and across the globe. Gathered around and formed by and enlivened through and caught up in this unfolding story that is being written by the God of Abraham and Sarah, and Hagar and Ishmael. Isaac and Rebecca, Esau and Jacob, Jacob and Rachel and Leah and Laban, and Joseph and all of his brothers, and all of those comings and goings that happened there. And those growing generations in the land of Egypt, this God at work forming this people, this community of faith. Even when it found itself in bondage and captivity, this God of Moses and Miriam and Aaron. And this God of liberation and redemption and release, now to be released and freed, to be a particular people, on down through that grand story of salvation and God at work now, to this people formed by and through and in Jesus Christ. And so then also this God of Anna and Jens, and that church in Hvetsel, Denmark, and Chicago, and Sandston, and then Richmond, Virginia, in Cumberland, Rhode Island, to be called and invited to this into this unfolding story of a particular people called to live out and live into life, a particular life and way of life in this good news of Jesus' way. And so where the gospel readings in these coming weeks, what we'll see in these Matthew readings that we are now shifting to, are really Jesus talking about and addressing what is this realm of God that we are called into, this kingdom of God, life in the community of God and of God's people. What is it like? What is it like to find yourself in, to exhibit the kingdom, the reign, the realm of God in the world? Because that's the type of community that God has been at work forming and shaping, reforming and reshaping throughout the generations and calling us and countless others into. We get a clue of what that's like, what's going on with that in this passage this morning, and we'll see this popping up in the coming weeks with Jesus saying things like he does here. The kingdom of heaven may be compared to, or the kingdom of heaven is like this, or again, another way to translate it, the realm of heaven, the times and places where God's will, God's way is at work and is bursting through the places and communities that are reflective of God and the ways of God and the good news of Jesus. And so when Jesus says the kingdom of heaven is like, do not only hear well, life after we die is like. No, this is also about us here. Right? What did Jesus also go around saying a lot? The kingdom of heaven has done what? Come near. And what did Jesus tell us to pray? And we pray together every week, thy kingdom come. When and where? On earth as it is in heaven. And even our own denomination, the Presbyterian Church USA, one of the historic guiding principles that we have is this thing called the great ends of the church. And there's six of them. And they're ends not as in everything is over and done and stopped, but ends as in purposes, the goals we're to be aiming at, the reasons we exist as a church. And one of the six is this: the exhibition of the kingdom of heaven to the world. That one of the purposes of the church, the community of God's people, the family of God, the place the Spirit uniquely dwells and is at work, the body of Christ, of which we are a particular instance here at Calvin, but also a part of the wider body. All those different images that Scripture gives us, one of the purposes is that together we live out, we show, we proclaim by embodying, and we work towards what we pray for on earth as it is in heaven, right? To display, to be an exhibit of here in this place. And so in the guidance and leading and strength and courage of the Spirit at work in us and in the body of Christ, what shape and form are communities of this kind of faith supposed to take and live out, supposed to look like? And so we find Jesus often taking opportunities to say things like, well, the kingdom, life in the realm of heaven is like this. And this morning we have here a passage that begins with a question about forgiveness and ends with Jesus somewhat playfully, somewhat disturbingly, and all around, I think, absurdly answering. And couching his answer as an image, as a parable that's inviting us to consider what this kingdom, this realm of heaven is like, and therefore how we are to live and live it out. I suspect many, if not all of us, are at least somewhat familiar with at least some of the things in this passage, right? Peter asks, begins this whole thing by saying, if I'm sinned against, how often should I forgive? Have you ever found yourself asking that question? You don't have to raise your hand. I'll raise mine for all of us, because I know. Right? As many as seven times? To which Jesus says, ha, nope. Not seven times. How about 77 times, Peter? Jesus is playing with Peter here. He's riffing off of Peter's phrasing. Seven was the number of completeness, of wholeness. And so you can imagine Peter being like, oh, I'm going to get a gold star for this one. Up to seven times? But Jesus says, nope, keep going to extra super duper double plus wholeness and completeness. Not seven, but 77. Jesus gives an overly exaggerated answer and then tells a strange, disturbingly and absurdly exaggerated parable. And Jesus gets all sorts of hyperbolic here. This parable about a king settling accounts with his servants, right? Servants probably meaning these provincial governors or those who were tasked with overseeing in some particular way localities of the kingdom. Right, which would include the duty of making sure taxes and tributes were taken and moved up the municipal lines throughout the kingdom. And it's absurd how Jesus describes this, because this one guy, it turns out, has fallen behind in what he was supposed to collect and pass on up. He's fallen behind 10,000 talents. Now, how much is that? Anybody know? Does anybody want to guess? All right, it's tough to nail down exactly, but it's somewhere, 10,000 talents is somewhere in the range of the amount an average day worker would earn over the course of somewhere between 30 and 100 million days. There are historical records that show the combined annual tribute and Perea and Judea and Samaria and Idumea at the time of the death of Herod the Great, which was only 30 or so years earlier than this, that the combined tribute owed was 800 talents of that entire geographic region. And this guy fell behind 10,000 talents. Right? So this is, right off the bat, this is an absurd story. a king goes to settle his accounts and discovered that against all odds of how economics and the physical universe can possibly work, this guy has fallen behind. He's fallen into debt by more money than he could ever pay back. Because it's more money than exists. So his life and that of his loved ones are forfeit. But long story short, the guy begs for more time to pay it back, which is absurd, because again, it is financially, economically, and literally impossible to come up with that amount of money, no matter how much time. But the king says, fine, I forgive. Literally, I release. That's what that word forgive means. I release you. But now this same guy goes to one of his fellow servants, a fellow provincial overseer, who owes him 100 denarii. Probably just hadn't passed it up the line yet. Maybe this first guy is just so bad collecting, that's how he got behind. But anyway, this guy owes him 100 denarii. Now 100 denarii, that is a number we can work with. Roughly the amount of a day's wage. So the second guy owes about 100 days worth of work, right? But the forgiven debtor treats him violently, grabs him by the throat, angrily, demanding he pay. His fellow servant falls down, pleads with him, using the exact same words the forgiven debtor has just used with the king. Give me some more time and I'll repay it. The difference being, of course, that the amount this second guy owes, repaying won't be easy, but it is entirely doable. But the forgiven debtor is having none of it and throws him into prison until he could repay it. Which again is absurd, because in prison he has no means of repaying. You see here what Jesus is setting up? In an extremely hyperbolic way, right? This contrast between receiving absurdly generous forgiveness and mercy on the one hand and the refusal to even consider forgiving much, much less. But then also, even in this parable about this call for seemingly unlimited forgiveness there is, did you notice this at the end of the parable? There is also a community that is still holding accountable those who are mistreating and harming others. That forgiven debtor that violently attacks the other servant. And the community comes and says no, and they go and make sure he's held accountable, right? So however we navigate and work through forgiveness, it doesn't neglect care for those vulnerable to the sin of others. These other servants, they see what the servant is doing to the second. They go make sure he gets held accountable for the harm he is causing. Whatever this is, it is not a license or a command to simply allow someone or yourself to continue to be harmed by another by just saying, oh well. So there's no doubt a lot to chew on or wrestle with here, or maybe a lot to let wrestle with us. Because you better believe that God can forgive our struggles to be able to forgive in this life, because God knows. God knows the seriousness of some of our sins against one another, and that forgiveness is not a simple thing. And so do not hear in this parable a threat about a hard-hearted king who can only forgive you if you somehow also get forgiveness exactly right. Remember, this is a parable filled with impossibly over-the-top, exaggerated images, and the lines between the literal and the hyperbolic and imaginative get blurred real quick. So it seems that Jesus' point here was less fine-tuning literal details, and much, much more about an invitation to take all of this kingdom of heaven business seriously. And that there is a connection here. How we offer is somehow connected to how we have received. The ways we are working to even try to forgive, to release others, release ourselves maybe, as imperfectly as we may do it and struggle with it and have to keep working at it, it is also somehow related to how we understand the ways that God has released us. And sometimes that struggling to forgive someone is also how God is releasing and setting you free. So there are echoes here of what, again, Jesus taught us to pray, right? Forgive us our debts, why or when or how, as we forgive our debtors. Release us as we release, or maybe even release us in our release of others. The realm of God, Jesus says, is a lot like this. And so here's what I've been really chewing on. Or rather, what from this parable that has been chewing on me is I've also been thinking about community and the communities to which we belong and are connected to, and a lot about our role as this particular community of faith. This first servant, I wonder about him, don't you? Why do you think he responded like that? He had just been forgiven and released from an unfathomable debt. And his response? And I wonder if part of his response was something like, man, whew, boy, dodged a bullet there. I got lucky there. So I need to be even more exacting and demanding of myself, sure, but also of everyone else, so I don't get into that position again. And I think about how we church people are sometimes really good at doing that too. We forget what the story actually is. We forget our own stories of God working in our lives and all the fits and starts and steps forward and backward and the getting it wrong and all as God is patiently there, patiently yet at work in our lives again and again. Sometimes in these ways over here, and other times not worrying so much about those, but in these ways over here. But all with patient, loving, steadfast kindness. And we forget that that is the great good news story that is being told and that God invites us to tell in our community and our life together. And that instead, what we sometimes do is we turn it into a story about demanding and expecting so much more of others, expecting and sometimes even demanding that everyone else's story with God lines up exactly like mine, like where ours is at that moment, or that it looks like the ways that we've grown to think and expect it to look like. And so the story that we become known for is one that is more about just burdening everyone with tougher and tougher demands to get it right and religious to-do lists that happen to line up with where we happen to be at a particular moment. And we forget that we are fundamentally a people called and formed and shaped and called again and reformed and reshaped again and again and again and again by the contours of grace and of being released. So when you get right down to it, our story as a community of God's people is one of simply inviting others, releasing others into that joy and the goodness of that same grace that we proclaim. And here on the 17th day of September 2023, we have had this different sort of summer. And as I see it, in a way, an opportunity of entering into a new season in the life of the church. One thing I love about this parable is that Jesus says the kingdom of heaven can be compared to this. But then the story that he tells, did you notice? It is really a story of what this realm of heaven, this kingdom of heaven, is not like. Did you notice that? The main character in this story does not do what is set up to be painfully obvious that he should do. And so I think that in telling the story this way too, Jesus is inviting, we are being invited not just to hear and go, okay, check, but we are being invited to wonder with his disciples, to imagine, to explore, well, if that's not what the realm of God is like, what is it like? And how might we find new ways to live into it? How might we be called in renewed or refreshed or in flat-out new ways altogether to be a community that exhibits this surprising and, dare we even say, from some of our economic, cultural, or social habits and perspectives, absurd new ways of community with one another and in and for and with the communities in which we find ourselves in this world? What would it look like? What could it look like? What might it yet look like if our default was less and less about what rights are ours to claim? That first servant, he had a right to claim what was owed to him. But instead, it was more and more and more about what grace we have and are therefore able to offer. What have we been released not just from, but what have we been released for? Perhaps even for the sake of inviting others to likewise be released, and all for the sake of this growing realm of God that Jesus continuously speaks of. What if our goal was not to keep a particular institution going or the way of being this particular institution going on and on and on, but what if it was rather to simply explore and imagine and discover new ways to exhibit this impractical, overly exaggerated, reckless, and foolish and absurd grace of God here as this particular community in and for and with all of the communities in which we live and move. Over the next bunch of weeks, Jesus is going to continue to invite us to consider in a bunch of different ways what this realm of God might actually look like, might actually call us to. Jesus began his ministry by proclaiming that in him the kingdom, the realm of heaven, had drawn near, and so calling all of us to be ever turning again and again and again toward and into that very good news. What are we here for? What community is God forming? Has God been forming? What type of community will God be forming? Beloved, may it be so for you and for me and for us. Amen. We sing now, right?
We do.
Yeah, okay.
It is. You'll find In Christ Alone is the insert in the bulletin.
Yes.
You can please stand and join.
Stand in body or in spirit. Let us sing.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still and striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ. heaven bursting forth in glorious day. Up from the grave he rose again, and as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I stand.
Everlasting. Amen. You may be seated.
As we consider our response to the good news of Jesus, hear again these words of the Apostle Paul, which remind us that if we live, we live to the Lord. And so we give of ourselves to God, to one another, and to the world, with our time, with our treasure, with our talents, in all the great variety of ways we live in the world, as a people released for such a life in Christ. You are invited to use this time now to consider how God may be inviting you to respond in your life and in our life together. And if giving to the ministry of this church is one of the ways you are called to give and to live to the Lord, you may give your offering as the offering plates are passed in the pews. If you use the online giving option, blue line on living cards, online giving cards are in the pews to be prayerfully placed in the offering plate as a sign of your giving. In whatever ways, let us give and respond as those who know we have been released into and freed for the very realm of God.
So Tristan, this is his first time coming up here to sing, and I can feel his nerves like coming off of him. So please give him some encouragement. He's really excited. He's been working all summer on this. So yeah, here we go. He really has this, and it sounds great.
Wandering through the desert, ain't seen a cloud in forever over me, but I believe your rain is coming. Yeah, I've been hanging on to high hopes, 'cause you're the ones making dry bones come to life. You're the light I put my trust in. You say it's gonna come true. You will lead me to the promised land. And everything you gonna happen, even though I haven't seen it yet. I will build a boat in the sand where they say it never rains. I will stand up in faith, I'll do anything it takes. Your wind in my sails, your love never fails or fades. I build a boat in the desert place, and when the flood and the water starts to rise, yeah, I'll ride the storm, cause I got you by my side. With your wind in my sails, your love never fails or fades. I build a boat, so let it rain. You're my map, you're my compass, you help me navigate the currents underneath. Take the lead, I surrender. And every word you say is gonna come true. You'll lead me to the promised land. And everything you say is gonna happen, even though I haven't seen it yet. I will build a boat in the sand where they say it never rains. I will stand up in faith, I'll do anything it takes. With your wind in my sails, your love never fails or fades. I build a boat in the desert place, and when the flood and the water starts to rise, yeah, I'll ride the storm, cause I got you by my side. With your wind in my sails, your love never fails or fades. I build a boat, so let it rain. In faith, I'll do anything it takes. With your wind in my sails, your love never fails or fades. I build a boat in the desert place, and when the flood and the water starts to rise, yeah, I'll ride the storm, cause I got you by my side. With your wind in my sails, your love never fails or fades. I build a boat, so let it rain.
Let us pray. Merciful and gracious God, you abound in steadfast love and faithfulness. And so with gratitude, we bring our gifts to you, gifts of time, of talent, of song and voice, and of our tithes. So bless these gifts and bless our lives, that together we may share your mercy and grace for the world that you dearly love. Amen. You may be seated. Okay, that was awesome. I heard a rumor that originally Derek and Steve were going to sing with them, and then at some point Tristan said, nah. I also heard that you were working on it and wanted to wait till my first Sunday back, which when I heard that, I may or may not have teared up a little bit. So thank you. That was awesome. We are about to come to the time of prayer together. As the church, as this community of God, before we do that, I just want to highlight a few things of what's going on in the life of the church. Many ways to be a part of what this community is about and what's going on. Betty Conlin has supplies for the next Woonsocket community meal lunches. The lunches are being made, I think, next Saturday, correct?
Yeah.
So if you're able to help out with that, you can see Betty. But she has the supplies in her car as we speak, down in the lower parking lot. So if folks immediately following the service, if a few people want to help her unload that, you can find Betty down by the door by the office and get that unloaded. Both Lunch with the Pastor and, I think, Senior Moments, is that right, DA, are resuming this Wednesday. You can see times and information in the bulletin. Also, Faithful Conversations is back. It's been since the pandemic. Faithful Conversations is a group that we had that we would meet on some sort of basis, regular basis, read books or talk about topics, just how faith intersects with our life in the world and things going on. So that is coming back this time around. It's going to be a book study and conversation about that. Beginning Sunday, October 1st, looking at through the fall, evening Sunday evening, 7 to 8:30. If you're interested, if this sounds interesting to you and you want to be a part of it, but that time doesn't work, see me. We can be flexible. That's the time I set up, but if we have a group that needs to meet on another time, if we can move it, we will. We're going to be reading together a book called The Ballot and the Bible that is... We live in a world where politics is very divisive and is difficult, and we're coming up on an election season, and it is tough. We live in this world, and we try to faithfully navigate it. This is a book that I think can help us do that together, even when, or maybe especially when, we disagree on particular things, but how we can faithfully come together. And be faithful to God and also to each other as siblings in Christ. So it's a good book. There's information. There's a sign-up sheet back there. And you can talk to me about more information. But that's coming up beginning October 1st. Also, there is lunch today. All is provided by the deacons. If you're here and you didn't know that, surprise, free lunch. There is such a thing. The deacons are providing it for everyone, so following the service, we'll just head down to the fellowship hall. But now it is time for us to go to the Lord in prayer. And as we do that, are there any prayer requests, any joys or concerns? I have no doubt there's a lot that I am still catching up on. But D.A., For your brother recovering from heart surgery. We'll continue to pray for him. Crystal, I saw your hand.
Continue prayers for my father-in-law, Tom, my dad, Kelly, my niece, Quinn, my whole family. And also, I have Joy. We're waiting to be 11 tomorrow.
Woo! All right.
We're very blessed to have her for
Yes. Happy birthday, a day ahead of time, Lorraine. There are others. Anna.
My friend Nicole, her daughter Natalie, who is turning 3 this week, which is just a blessing in itself, has neuroblastoma type cancer. But she had a scan 2 days ago, and the cancer has not progressed anymore. So the chemo is working.
Good. And that is Natalie is the girl's name. Yes, we'll keep Natalie in our prayers, and Nicole. Steve.
A close friend of our family's, Candy Martell, was in a really bad bicycle accident. She's doing better, but she's working her way slowly out of ICU.
Okay. Candy is in ICU because of an accident and slowly recovering. We'll keep Candy in our prayers. Rachel. Yeah, it really is.
Yeah. Did I see another hand?
Kurt. Keep Trudy in our prayers. Yeah. Okay, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Excuse me. It is with one mind in Christ and one heart in the Spirit, Lord, that we gather in prayer, for you are the Lord of heaven and earth. In the name of Jesus, we pray for the church. Let us live as new and holy people, as those not just delivered from the ways and results of sin and death, but as those released into all that is new, life-giving, and life-enabling in the grace and life of Christ. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In the name of Jesus, we pray for this earth, your creation, and for those who are suffering under and through storms and floods, fires and earthquakes. And Lord, help us to be good stewards of your creation that you have entrusted to our care. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In the name of Jesus, we pray for all nations. We pray for leaders, for the leaders of our nation and the leaders of our communities, and indeed those of all nations. And Lord, lead all the peoples of the earth by the light of your presence into ways that seek justice and love mercy and walk humbly with you. And so to live in your peace and for the flourishing of all. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In the name of Jesus, we pray for this and all of our communities. We are grateful, Lord, for Kathy Cooper's ministry with and among us this summer. And as this church was blessed, we pray that she was likewise blessed, that you would bless her and her family and her ministry in the years to come. And may she know our gratitude. And for all who took on something new this summer, Lord, allow us to learn from one another, from our siblings and neighbors, respecting different patterns and practices of life, so that in the rich variety of life in your grace, we may more and more reflect your beautiful kingdom. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And in the name of Jesus, we pray for loved ones. Bless those for whom we pray, either with our voices or in our hearts. Lord, heal diseases, deliver from troubled bodies, troubled minds, or troubled hearts. Bring good news for the poor and poor in spirit, release for those held captive in one way or another. Bring renewed vision and freedom for the oppressed. Renew strength and satisfy with goodness. Lord, we lift up on this day Thomas and the Shank family, DA's brother, Dave's father, and Crystal's father and niece, and Natalie and Nicole and Cindy and Trudy, for all who are recovering from or preparing for surgeries or medical procedures. We celebrate wonderful milestones like birthdays. Pray that you would bless Lorraine in this coming year. And Lord, we lift up now in this moment all the prayers that silently sit in our hearts or on our minds. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And enable us, O God, by the power of your Spirit, to live our lives in a way that is worthy of the gospel, to the glory of the name that is above all names, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who taught us to pray together with boldness. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Please stand in body or in spirit as we sing O Christ, the Great Foundation, hymn number 443. We'll be singing verses 1, 2, and 3. O Christ, the Great Foundation, people stand. Reminder, there is lunch right down the hall in just a moment. So let me, before the benediction, let me say a blessing for the food we are about to receive. Lord, for the gift of nourishment in body, mind, and soul, we are grateful. And we ask that you would bless this time of eating and sharing a meal and sitting at table with one another. Bless the food to strengthen our bodies. For your service, bless our fellowship to strengthen our spirits for your service, and bless the hands that have provided. Amen. And now the love of God the Father, the grace of Jesus the Son, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit is with you this day and always. And so, beloved, let us go to lead a life worthy of our calling. Amen.